Change it as host. And okay. Good afternoon, all, and welcome to our 12th session. Today, our topic is sports and performance psychology. And with us, we've got our expert, Sumaira Tandon, who works with squash athletes based out of Delhi. And so we are ready to take over. So, Sumaira, please. Share your screen and take over.
Hi, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay. And is my video audible as well? Visible as well?
No, I don't see your video. Yes, now I see you.
Okay,
so just
perfect.
Share the screen. The third button at the bottom, just click on that and share it.
Right. Good afternoon, everyone. Like Cyrus introduced me, I'm a sports and exercise psychologist. I work with the performance of athletes. I've been working in this field since almost 10 years now. I work a lot with racket sports. And especially squash is one of the main racket sports that I work with in India. I would be scared sharing the screen. All right, here we are. All right. So, sorry, I think. There's some error in my sharing. Keep saying that they can't open the file. Just give me a second.
The file was open. Maybe just try reopening it. Click on share again and reopen the file.
I think what has happened is that Rishabh had sent me the PPT again, but the format is a little different of that PPT. So I'm just going to open the PPT that I have. This one. Right. Right, is it visible now?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. All right. Okay. So, shall I start with them?
Yes, please.
Okay. All right. So today our topic is in sports psychology. It's about communication and goal setting. The topic is specific to the coaches for high performance. And we are going to be talking about the relationship, the communication between coaches and the athletes. To start with, I would like to introduce what is sports psychology. I'm pretty sure that everyone knows what exactly is sports psychology, but it would be good if we got to know a little bit more about it. So sports psychology is all about how we study the brain, the behavior in terms of athletic performance. So how we correlate, combine the understanding of an individual behavior in terms of how they perform. So what you emote, what your emotions are, will in turn affect your performance. And at the same time, what individual you are will affect your performance, and how you perform will affect you as an individual and your emotions at the same time. So it's sort of a give and take relationship when it comes to understanding of sports psychology. So let's say if there is an athlete who has, let's say, anger issues. Now, those anger issues may or may not be really affecting him on his court. Maybe those anger issues are just happening at home. But at the same time, even if it's happening at home, somehow, somewhere, they are percolating into his performance, which we cannot see on the court. So that's why we need to address those areas that are happening at the home so that they don't affect the performance. Now, the same athlete, when is not able to perform well on the court, in tournaments or in practice, may come back home and have a change in behavior or may have an advanced anger issue happening at home. So the same way in sports psychology, we try to understand how your performance affects you as an individual and how you as an individual would affect your performance. If anyone has a query, they can interrupt me in the middle and just ask me about that slide if I'm not being clear enough. Now, these are a few of the areas that we help the athlete in. So competitive anxiety to start with, which we all know every athlete comes across. And sometimes it's visible, sometimes it's not visible. But when we talk about competitive anxiety, it's usually not just in competitions. It's also during the time when we are preparing for the competitions. So as the competition is nearing, we may see that the athlete is facing competitive anxiety. But again, competitive anxiety is not something just that we see in competitions. So the next point is transferring training performance to competition performance. That's another area that we must have seen athletes struggling with over the period of time. How the athlete performs during training is not able to transform into competitions. Understanding various emotions during pre and post competitions. So when we talk about an athlete's emotions, they can be split into widely three phases, that is pre, during, and post competitions. So as coaches, you must have noticed that some athletes, they are more in control before the competition, but during the competition, it's easy for them to just lose control of their performance or of their strategies. And post-competition, they get absolutely all right and they are able to do whatever is required. So the same can happen that some athletes are very calm, controlled in the pre-duration, but the moment they enter the competition, things are not as much in their control. So what we are trying to do here, what we try to do here with the athletes is we try to segregate these three areas and we understand how each athlete works pre, during, and post emotionally, and we work with them in that duration. So we work with them for that duration. The next point for us that we usually work with athletes is managing support system, parents, coach, and trainers. So just like today that I would be talking to you about certain areas, we do work with trainers, other experts, and parents as well. Holistic development. So in sports psychology or just in to work with the psychology of an athlete, even as a coach, you would know that you would be trying to balance their life between their studies, their life with their family, their recreational, if they are involved in recreational sports, that, and their competitive sport. So this is another area where athletes require a lot of work.
Could we have the slideshow view, please? If you just come down where you are, it's the third button. Where you, not that. Just come all the way down on the left-hand side. Yeah, the next one. The third one on the right. Yeah, perfect.
Okay, so with this one, the moment I move my cursor, it moves away. Okay, so I'll try not to move my cursor. Okay. Is that better, Cyrus?
Perfect.
Okay, thanks. These are a few more areas that we work with. Expectations, goal management. Goal management is one thing that we are going to be working with today, where you can help yourselves and you can also help athletes or work with athletes in terms of goal management. We work with team cohesion, team effectiveness, how to focus during competitions, understanding terms like confidence, attention, concentration, motivation, self-belief. So these are some basic areas where we work with the athletes. Probably you can ask me questions about these areas later once we are done. So in sports psychology, there are a lot of techniques and there are a lot of areas where we work with which are beneficial to coaches as well. And one of the most essential tools that we work with is how we communicate effectively with athletes. So you might be in squash and you must be working with individual athlete, but at the same time, you are also working with a group of athletes. So you must have an understanding how handling one athlete is different from handling a group of athletes. And having the knowledge of how to communicate with them makes it all the more easier. So these are the five fundamentals of strong athlete-coach relationship. So the first one is communication. In communication, there has always been a lot of debate in sports psychology about should the communication, when it comes to coaches, should it be more autocratic or democratic? So I would not say that communication should only be democratic, because somehow, somewhere, the right kind of autocratic approach also helps. So autocratic is more about when the coach is more domineering in the relationship in terms of communication and tries to dictate what is to be done. But at the same time, if we manage it the right way, autocratic communication is not negative. It has to be balanced well with democratic communication. So democratic communication means where the coach and the athlete, they together decide what the course of their planning has to be, what the course of their training has to be, how they are supposed to work together. So over the period of time, a coach has to mix the autocratic and democratic together, because if it is just autocratic, then the athlete may start losing interest, may start become submissive, may start become scared of the coach. But if it's mixed with democratic, where the athlete feels that, yes, I have a lot of charge in my planning and I'm able to control most of what I have to do on the court in terms of where my head is. If there is one day when I'm feeling extremely tired and I share that with the coach is just not going to dismiss me. The coach will probably understand me, but will also put his foot down in terms of that, okay, you should have recovered a day earlier. So instead of probably training for 2 hours, today you can train for 1 hour, but this should not happen again. So the mix of autocratic and democratic has to be placed together. The next point, the next fundament that we have is positive reinforcement. I'm sure we all understand what's positive reinforcement. We understand the carrot, the story of the carrot and the stick. So positive reinforcement and negative reinforcement have been in debate in terms of teaching and education with educators since a long time. But this is a very black and white area where I can definitely say that positive reinforcement has a lot of research that says that, yes, it works. So in positive reinforcement, we try to use the reward, but the reward only works when the athlete has understood some sort of punishment. So over the period of time, it depends upon the coach and the family, or just the coach or the team of coaches, to understand if the athlete is not responding to positive reinforcement, if they are not responding to rewards, if they are not responding to them being given a lot of leverage during their training, then could it be because they don't know what is the understanding of the right kind of punishment, the positive punishments? So that's another area where the coach and athlete relationship works well if it's balanced between positive and negative reinforcement. The third point for us is respect. It's very simple. To gain respect, we have to give respect. So with an athlete, it has to be done from an early age. If an athlete does not understand what is to give respect, or does not understand when he or she is getting respect at an early age, that is from the age of, let's say, 4 years to 8 years, then after 8 years, it becomes a little difficult for athlete to understand if they have to give the respect to the authority. So this is the place where, this is the area where we see a lot of athletes struggling in managing if they can kneel down to the authority for their own good. But if the coaches understand that what background of the athlete is, how their household is, or where they've come from, if they understand how they understand giving respect is good or not, then it'll become easier for the coach to work with that athlete. But at the same time, I've always seen that respect is a very tricky area. Not all athletes understand respect as an equilibrium, as a platform where they have to meet on equilibrium. They usually understand respect as that, okay, the higher the authority, the more the respect. So this is again an area where the coach will have to work with the athlete upon. The fourth area is availability. Now this area is again extremely very subjective to all the coaches, because not all coaches have a lot of time to give to the athlete or the athletes that they are working with. But you can always fix, let's say, one day in a week or 1 hour in a week for the athlete and say that, okay, from 4 to 5 p.m., I'm going to be available for any of the issues that you have. And my availability is only for this 1 hour. So in this 1 hour, you can message me, you can call me, you can come and meet me. So this open door policy in terms of availability always really helps athletes in being able to see their coach as an available entity, as opposed to someone who will only speak to them or talk to them about the training or about the competition planning or if they have not done well in the competition. So most of the times, athletes struggle to open up and say things to their parents because the parents try to not interfere. Most of the parents try to not interfere between the coach and the athlete. At least that's what they portray to the athlete. And once that is done, the athlete has no option left. They cannot approach the coach. They cannot approach the parents. And that's when all the turmoil happens, when the athlete is not able to open up and they don't know who to talk to. So the availability is again something which as an athlete, as a coach, you'll always have to keep specified slots available for your athletes. The last one for us is trust. Again, mutual trust is something that is a little bit tricky to understand when you're working with a lot of athletes, but you can always have a work spreadsheet in which you can have these 5 pointers and you can quality wise, you can rate all your athletes and understand that, okay, in communication, what autocratic, democratic, which part does my athlete understand this particular one? Which one works well with positive reinforcement? Which one understands that giving respect is a must for taking respect? So you can have a work spreadsheet in which you can have qualitative analysis of all these 5 areas. And this is going to help you understand your athletes better and probably how you can give more to your athletes. The next part for us is why is communication essential? So a lot of times, all of us, we talk a lot about communication. We must have simple communication with coaches, with athletes, with parents. A lot of times we talk about the benefits of communication, but we never really sit down and think about what are these areas where communication actually helps us. What are the essential parts where I'm going to be using communication effectively? So for coaches to communicate effectively, they have athletes, they have other coaches, they have administrators, they have parents that they need to communicate effectively with. A lot of times we only focus on athletes or we only focus on parents. But at the same time, the communication has to be effective even with your other coaches, even with your peers, even with your other administrators that you're working with, the managers, other people managing your academy, or probably your subordinates. So communicating effectively is not only for athletes and parents. Coaches have to do it with all other support system as well. The next point for us is that the coaches must be thoughtful, not only in sending clear and understandable messages, but also in listening and understanding their athletes. So now, till now, we were talking about how coaches have to understand athletes. At the same time, how the coaches have to communicate with the athletes. But at the same time, we have to also understand if you are understanding the athlete the right way, if you are understanding the parents, if you're understanding other coaches and everyone else the right way as well. So it's sort of a give and take relationship where athletes talk to you if you're understanding it correctly or not, or if the athlete is able to give you clear communication pointers or not, depends not only upon how you are communicating, it also depends upon what sort of feedback you are giving. So if you feel that at one point of time, athlete is not communicating effectively, you can always communicate back that, okay, these are the effective ways of communication with us. We should sit down. There's this particular time when we have to fix a session just to discuss, just to communicate, and make the athlete learn it like that. The next point for us is how you communicate with your athletes directly affect how they perceive you in return and how they feel about themselves. Now, in this, the more important point is how they feel about themselves. So the way you communicate with the athlete is able to communicate back with you. And in turn, the way they perceive themselves, the way they are able to perceive themselves as an athlete, as someone who's working with a team or with you, they will have certain feelings of confidence about themselves. So our aim stays that we want to inherently make the athlete confident about themselves, and that can easily be done with the way you communicate. So when the athlete accomplishes something that you want them to do, so these are few do's and don'ts. So when you want the athlete to accomplish something you want them to do, the do's would be that you reward them immediately for encourage them. Now, this is part of the positive reinforcement. The next is that you showcase that you appreciate their focus, efforts, participation, execution, performance. Now, when athlete accomplishes something, our main aim has to be to tell the athlete that, okay, it's not about you winning. It's not about the results. It's about that these are the three pointers or these are the four pointers quality-wise that I have assessed in you. Let's say your focus, your confidence, your attention, your effort, the fact that you participated in this, the way you executed your shots or the way you performed today was definitely better than your previous one. So we try to encourage the athlete not in terms of, oh, great that you won the match, or that, oh, your score was really good, you really beat that player with a good score. That's not the right way to showcase that you appreciate the athlete. The way of appreciation is better when you split it down into more explainable areas and you're able to give them more specific qualitative and quantitative pointers instead of just talking about winning and losing. The third point that we must be doing is in order to help the athlete progress better, even for themselves and even for you as a coach, it's always better to notice and it always better is to talk about their strengths more instead of thinking about their negative areas that they have, that they should have done. So you notice their strengths, you link it to why it worked and how it helped them on that day of game. So everything, every positive thing that you do, it sticks in the athlete's memory and it builds on their self-esteem. So our aim is to be able to keep reinforcing the strengths that the athletes have and to keep linking it to why it worked. So because you were confident today, that's why when you started losing scores very early, or when your performance started going down, you were able to pick it up. Why? Because you were confident. So try to link their emotions, try to link their psychological areas to their performance, and this helps them to believe, to have more belief in your feedback. The don'ts that we have to avoid, I'm sure we all know most of these don'ts, but just to have a recap about it, we have to avoid constantly saying that we expect excellence from them. So instead of always telling them that, okay, today you were brilliant, like you've never been. So this sort of a terminology always puts them under more pressure. We have to always tell them that you don't have to become good, you have to become better. So becoming good means that the athlete is aiming to just find one sort of perfection. We want the athlete to keep becoming better, keep doing better. So instead of saying that, oh, you were excellent, you were perfect, you're better than yesterday, or you were better than the last match, and we can still do better. So this is the way that we have to try and communicate to the athlete. Another area that we have to avoid doing, that is rewarding only excellence. So on the day when the athlete has had an average performance, or probably in the results, he or she has not won, but the performance has been average, it's always good to even award those performances, because if we only keep awarding excellence, the athlete would start getting scared of failures. So we have to keep awarding, I would not say failures, but yes, the trials, the attempts. The third point for us is never take their skills and abilities for granted. So let's say there is an athlete who is trying to do something new on the court. It does not match with your strategy, and he or she should not be really doing it right before the competitions. So instead of putting them down and saying that, okay, stop playing around, or why are you attempting these new things, it's always good to tell them that, all right, I understand this is a new skill that you're trying to develop. We can look at it after the competition, but till competition, let's work on this XYZ thing. If, let's say, you find out that they have some other skill or ability on the court or outside the court, it's always good to communicate that you appreciate them spending time in that skill development as well, instead of just trying to tell them that, okay, don't go for your music classes. You're wasting your time there for 2 hours. Instead, you're skipping your training. So leave music. We have to find a balance for them. So probably have a talk with the parents or have a talk with the other experts and tell them, okay, you can go for music classes for 1 hour, and 1 hour you can come for your sports training. So we have to always take all their skills in focus, because if we are not taking care of their skills, then they are not going to be accomplishing the goals that we set with them.
I have a question over here. Could I?
Yes.
Okay, so we have put over here about awarding and rewarding the athletes.
Right. Yes.
Now, I have also heard, and in fact, you know, it's in my mind always, Sachin Tendulkar, for example, he had always said his coach never ever said any good word to him. And that's what in his final speech when he retired, he said, at least my coach now should say well done. And he said he'd never told me that before. So I know that's an extreme, but just your ideas on it, because we as coaches, sometimes we do too much and sometimes we don't do we do too little. So what is actually a balance? Because this is something we are dealing with all the time. We are dealing with children on a daily basis. So how much is good and how much means, rather, I don't want to say too much, because then they get complacent as well. So what is good and what is not so good?
Right. So Cyrus, I would like to say something before I answer your question. That is, just like when you become parents, the baby does not come with a manual. As parents, you don't get a manual. So being coaches, you are the parents of the skills, of the skill development for that child. So being parents of the skill development, you don't get a manual. So no coach gets a manual saying, okay, this is right, this is wrong. We can only talk about what is the best that can be done and what is the best that can be avoided. There are no foolproof coaching strategies, as I'm sure you must have also realized over the period of time. But coming back to your question now, yes, there are a lot of athletes, not only in sports, but in other fields as well, where when it comes to, let's say, when students are preparing for competitive examinations, and I get a lot of such clients who say that, you know, their parents are ruthless, they are okay if they are studying for 24 hours straight without sleeping, etc., etc. And this is how they became where they are. So there is no right or wrong in terms of when you're being parents. Are you doing it right for your child or wrong for your child? So you are also the parents in terms of skill development. So there is no drastic understanding of right or wrong. But yes, when we talk about what is the maximum that can get us the best out of an athlete, so these are the more guaranteed guidelines. So the guaranteed guideline says that if you understand your athlete better, the chances are burnout is going to be less. The chances of burnout are going to be less. The chances are that the goals that you set with the athlete and for the athlete, you both as a coach and athlete will achieve it. The chances are, so it's not sort of an hit and trial. So if let's say that there are 10 athletes who are being coached the way Sachin Tendulkar, let's say, was coached, we don't know how many actually are going to really succeed. But when we talk about these researches, when we talk about these available guidelines, yes, we can say that, okay, if there are 10 athletes, then the chances are at least 4 of these are going to end up becoming successful. So that's the only promising thing that we can say is right or wrong. But again, because he was Sachin Tendulkar, I'll have to really probably talk to him more and understand where he got his motivation from when he was getting all negative reinforcements. That's going to be a really interesting research. I hope that answers your question. And like you said that you don't know what is too much and too less. So again, you don't have to know what is too much or too less. You just have to keep believing. As a coach, you have to keep believing in yourself. And as a coach, you have to fulfill your own goals. And at the same time, while you're fulfilling your own goals, your athlete's goals are also going to get fulfilled. But the focus has to be on your mental and physical well-being as well. So there is, I remember I got a, I started working with a coach 6-7 months back. Coach was not health-wise doing very well. And one of his athletes was going to US for a tournament. And this coach, the doctor told him not, he cannot travel. But this coach, kept fighting. Hello? Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, sorry. Right. So this coach was adamant that he has to travel regardless of his health issues. And he did. And he came back. He was fine. But then when I started, when I was working with him, our first step was that coach has to work on their health as well. You cannot, giving too much does not mean that you're only giving too much of positive reinforcement to the athlete. Giving too much sometimes also means that you're giving too less of positive reinforcement to yourself. So with time, you'll have to understand that if you want to give as much as you want to give to your athlete, you'll have to keep giving to yourself as well in terms of psychological well-being. I hope that was clear enough for us. Now, these are some of the communication tips that we have. If I don't know if you'll be getting these notes later, but if you're not, you can always write these down. So these communication tips talk about listening verbally and non-verbally. I know not all coaches have so much time that they can sit and just observe the non-verbals of the athlete, that what their nervous tics are, or where, at what point of time when they start, when their performance starts going down, what do they physically start doing? They can't constantly just understand the non-verbals. But yes, when we start understanding the verbals, the chances are that we'll also slowly start understanding the non-verbals of the athletes. But again, in order to understand either verbal or non-verbal, you'll have to start the conversation to make the athlete understand your verbals first. Once they start understanding a little bit of your verbals, it'll become a two-way street and it'll become easier for you to communicate. Next is rapport building and trust building from day one. So the first day you get the athlete, there is no one recipe for each athlete because each athlete, each individual is different. You'll have to do the rapport building and the trust building with each athlete in different way. But if the intention starts from the day one, with some athlete, it may take you 3 days. With some athlete, it may take you just 2 days. But again, with some athlete, it might take you 3 to 4 weeks. And I've also met coaches who feel that sometimes even after 2 years, they've not been able to do that trust building with that one particular player. So this is, again, something that happens over the period of time and we cannot fixate a duration on it. The next point for us would be to understand the player and the individual athlete that you're coaching. So I know that a lot of times you have a lot of players that you're working with and to individually understand them becomes very, very difficult. But sometimes it helps if you're able to observe them or if you're able to give them a journal or if you're able to understand them in a way that, okay, this one likes to write and probably will write, or this one likes to make notes on the phone and might actually make notes on the phone, or this XYZ always comes early, so probably I can go and talk to him for 3 to 4 minutes when he reaches early on the courts. So understanding the individual player and just giving them probably 2 to 3 minutes every day to each one helps in better communication. And shift focus to becoming better than becoming perfect. This is something that I just mentioned, I think 10, 15 minutes back, that our aim is to communicate to the athlete that they don't have to become perfect. Our aim is to put across to them that they have to become better today than they were from yesterday, become better tomorrow than from what they were today. So becoming better is our aim than always becoming perfect. And that's another thing that I have observed on the court when coaches, let's say, give a task to the athlete saying that, okay, go hit the ball and do this particular exercise till it becomes perfect. And the athlete keeps doing it. And then you come and then you look at it and then you say, okay, perfect. Now you can stop doing it. That puts across a sort of a confusing statement or idea to the athlete, because perfection is something that cannot essentially be just achieved in one day of task. So our aim stays that we have to put across to the athlete that, okay, this task that I gave to you, yes, you've become better from what you were 1 hour back, but we have to keep working on it, or you have to keep working on it, probably by watching your own videos, probably by coming 15 minutes early or by staying 10, 15 minutes late. So becoming perfect is sort of an incorrect terminology that we put across. The fifth point is extremely, extremely essential. That is, communicate your values and ethics. So you, who you are as a coach, who you are as an individual, you have to put across your values and ethics to the athletes, because athletes will not work with you and understand this by themselves coherently. They will never understand what is to not cheat. They will not understand what is to how they have to not react to wrong calls. They will not understand when a wrong call happens, how they have to react to the second wrong call. So there are a lot of such areas that would require an athlete to build values and ethics And that's best when it comes from the coach, because athlete is not going to adapt to values and ethics that they get from home as easy as they would do from what they get from the coaches. And once the values and ethics come at par with each other for the coach and the athlete, the communication becomes smoother, the understanding of preparation of competitions becomes smoother, the feedback becomes smoother. The next point of for us is very simple, practice what we preach. So whatever you tell the athlete, we have to try and first show it to the athlete. So if you tell the athlete, okay, you have to come on time. And if you're late on one particular training session, I'm not saying that you should give explanation to the athlete, but you should tell the athlete that, okay, today I was late. I'm at fault. I'm not saying that this is how one should be coming to practices. So next time, if anyone's late, it is not going to be taken lightly either, just because I was late today. So try to put across a sort of an apologetic understanding where you are putting across to the athlete that you were not comfortable being late for the training session. But for whatever reasons you were late, you will try to not be late again. So you have to try practice what is preached. Again, the end, the last and one of the most important tips that we might have for the day, and that is you have to be their strength and not their fear. So the athlete has to trust you, has to respect you, but at the same time has to find their strengths in you and not be scared of you. So they should do well in a match, or they should think about coming out of the match and sharing the feedback with you, not because they're scared, but because they are in sync with how you're going to be feeling. So they know how you're going to be thinking, how you're going to be reacting, and they know that no matter what happens, you are going to work upon these things with the coach in the training. So instead of them being scared that, okay, now I'm going to get punished, or now I'm going to get shouted at, or now I'm going to be berated or insulted or being compared to other athletes, they should not have these fears. So once this understanding is very clear between the coach and the athlete that you are the strength, and no matter from what height the athlete falls, you're always there to catch them. That is going to help the communication flow much better as compared to anything else. So, sorry. That's that, I think, for our communication. Oh, no, we do have a last point that I really wanted to discuss. I'm not sure if I should discuss this right now or I should discuss this in the end. So this is more about the in-between points preparation, the 90 seconds that a lot of athletes talk to me about. So I work upon this with the athletes a lot, especially if course and squash, what they have to do during the break, what they have to do during the points break, what they have to do during any medical breaks that they get. And this stands as a major point even in squash. So in squash, these are the four very special steps that we take. So these are the essential steps that the athlete has to take. And if you can always put it across to the athlete, it will become much easier for them when it comes through you. So the first step, the moment the point ends or the break starts, let's say, is positive physical response. So the positive physical response has two meanings to it. One meaning is that whatever the result of that previous point has been, despite that result, you show a positive physical response. So even if you've lost the point, or even if you've not played well in the point, your shoulders should be straight, your chin should be up, your chest should be high. So everything has to be about showing positivity through your physical response. So when we talk to the athlete in terms of phases that they have to cover in 90 seconds, we say that you have to cover the 20 minutes of work in 90 seconds. So these four points are the points that essentially are almost equivalent to 20 minutes of work for an athlete that we can cover in 90 minutes. So positive physical response, regardless of what the point is, you always have a straight face or a smile on your face, no dejection. The positive physical response doesn't only help you, but it also helps the environment that you're creating inside the court, and does not let the opponent think that, okay, they've almost broken you now. So that's the first step. The next step is, now that you have portrayed to yourself and to your environment that everything is positive and and your physical response is in your control, the next step comes relaxation. Now, because you're almost nearing to the end of the break, so now next step is your relaxation, and everyone has their own relaxation techniques. So it could be in terms of breathing, it could be in terms of self-talk, it could be in terms of quick PMR, progressive muscle relaxation. So any relaxation technique that the athlete wants to use, may it be, changing the grip from, so whatever your dominant hand is, you change it into the non-dominant hand, and then you do your relaxation. Before preparation, you change the hands of the racket grip. The next step for us is, once you have become more relaxed in terms that your heart rate has come down, the next step for us is preparation. So now the preparation is not only about your physical preparation, that you wipe your face, you wipe your arms, you get ready. The preparation is also your mental preparation. So what do you want to do in the next point? What do you want to do in the next step as your strategy? What is the next goal that you have in your match? Or what is your next starting of routine that you want to do? So preparation comes in a lot of phases. One is your physical preparation. Second is your mental preparation. And the third one is your strategic preparation. So physical preparation would again be you getting up, you wiping yourself, washing your face, drinking. Your mental preparation would be, you'd be thinking about strategies, what I have to do next, what are my strengths, how can I play better, or how can I continue playing the way I'm continuing. And the third one is strategic. So immediately thinking about what I've had a talk with the coach, or probably if you get a chance to talk to the athlete can communicate back with you, or you can communicate something to the athlete. So that becomes the preparation part. Now comes the last activation part, which is again done in 3 to 5 seconds. That is athlete quickly doing activation techniques or getting ready to enter the match now. Now this point is somewhere between athlete starting from relaxed state, getting more into state of activation. So our main aim is to not have the athlete be extremely calm and entering the match again. Our main aim is that the athlete was relaxed right before they were thinking clear about the preparation, because before preparation, you want the athlete's mind to be clear and relaxed. So the athlete relaxes, prepares, and then comes and then starts to get into that activation stage, where they start doing a little bit of warm up, they start doing on the spot jogging, or they start doing a little bit of shadow. So every athlete has different activation routine. So the fourth point for us is athlete getting into activation routine and starting. Sorry. So these are the four steps that we cover in 90 seconds. Now the next essential tool for us is effective goal setting. So now effective goal setting, see the first understanding that we need to have about goal setting is, are we just looking at goal setting as something that has to be done because everyone talks about it? Or are we going to be doing goal setting because we understand why it is important, what it actually does? So understanding that first is more important than just doing goal setting, because everyone expects us to do goal setting. So benefits of goal settings are written right here, if you can have a read. It brings focus to the right tasks and steps that we are aiming for. It mobilizes efforts in proportion to demands of the task. So it helps us in, so we must have heard a lot of times, work smarter, not harder. So instead of giving your 10 hours in a week to a task which only requires 3 hours, it's better to do goal setting, finish that task in 3 hours rather than spend 10 hours and then finish that task. So it mobilizes your efforts in proportion to demands of the task. It enhances persistence. So it makes you a persistent individual in terms when it comes to achieving your goals. So it keeps telling you where you have to push yourself a little harder. What so let's say if you fixed a goal for a month, and in a month you've not been able to achieve it, but again you were able to achieve it instead of in 30 days, you were able to achieve it in 40 days. So with that task, you'd know, okay, this required a little bit of persistence. Now let's say there is a task that you were supposed to achieve in 20 days, but even in 50 days you were not able to achieve it. Immediately you would know, okay, for this area I require more persistence. So for future, you'll always get to know that, okay, if I'm setting goals for myself, I need to set a more realistic goal. That is, instead of thinking that this task I'm going to be able to do today, not possible. I'll definitely be able to do it in 1 week. Why? Because earlier, this told us what our persistence percentage is. And when we understood our persistence percentage, that is, how much the goal setting has to persist us to achieve a certain goal and how long for, and then we achieve it. So understanding your persistence rate and letting goal setting enhance our persistence is another benefit that we get from goal setting. It encourages us to develop right strategies for achieving our goals. So a lot of times we know we have to achieve a goal, and the first thing that comes to our head, the pathway, we take that pathway. After some time, we realize, okay, this pathway is not really helping me achieve this goal. May it be in terms of achieving a certain goal for an athlete, may it be a career goal, may it be a goal that you may have for the academy. So for that particular goal, if you feel that, okay, I have chosen a strategy, the first strategy that came on top of my head, I've chosen that, but it's not really working. That means that what was required from you was to sit down, look at 3 to 4 strategies, pick out the best one, choose that for yourself through the smarter goal strategies that I'll be covering in 2 minutes, and then set your strategy for that goal accordingly. Just thinking that, okay, I have a glass in front of me, I have to pick up that glass and drink water. So the first strategy for me is to extend my arm and drink it. But what if there is something in between? What if there is another bottle in between? Or what if there is some object in between that might hinder me that I have not thought about? So all of setting our goals properly and thinking about the correct strategy would tell us, I have to put my hand around the bottle and then get hold of the glass and then have a sip. So what we have to try and do in our career, in terms of athlete, in terms of our own work, is find out strategies that fit the best for our goals. These are a few of the added benefits. It helps us stop procrastinations. It helps us be accountable for what we have to do. When we have goals in front of us and we are not able to achieve it in the right timeline, we look at those goals and we know that we are not able to achieve these goals in this given certain time or in this given certain period, and we are responsible for it. So we have to understand, we have to take ownership of our goals and then work with those goals. It increases our productivity and improves time management. It eases up decision making. It provides measurement to progress. It's always good to have goals that we can measure, because it adds up to our progress. It helps us to understand that, okay, if this particular goal can be measured, then I can attach more goals to it that can be measured and make it a proper work spreadsheet and measure all my goals. The last point for us as a benefit is it helps us achieve better and faster results. That's all something that we want. We look at results. We want the results, and this helps us get faster results. This is a small well, I'll elaborate a little bit on it, of smarter goals. I'm sure you all understand smarter goals, and you can probably take a picture of this as well to understand. Our goals have to be specific. They have to be measurable, achievable, relevant, time-bound, exciting, and in the end, recorded. So in terms of recorded, what we mean is that our goals should be documented for measurement so that they can be reviewed later. To start with, let's start with specific goals. We just have to have all the details about the goal, that what is the goal, who is involved in the goal, why is the goal here, where do we have to reach with this goal, when do we want to reach through the goal. Next, it has to be measurable. How much of it we want to achieve it, where do we want to reach in it, how often do we want to do this particular goal, how many times are we going to do this goal. So let's say if you have the goal to help an athlete reach a certain, qualify for a certain tournament, you have to have all the specifications of who this athlete is, where he has already stood, what all he has been doing, why do you think that he can achieve this. The next step for us would be how you want to measure this goal. Are you going to measure it in physical fitness, psychological fitness, his skill accomplishments? So all of those things have to be measurable. Then the third point is achievable. Is the goal achievable? Or is it that the moment an athlete is 8 years old, we are thinking that, okay, next is Olympics. We have to look at more achievable short-term goals first, and then we have to go ahead. So is the goal realistic and reasonable? Then next is relevant. How relevant is the goal to what is the goal that you have set? How relevant is it to your requirement? So a lot of times we set certain goals which may or may not be very relevant to, let's say, you wanting to let the athlete qualify for a certain tournament. So an athlete wanting, let's say, new shoes, and they set a goal that, okay, I want new shoes, in terms of my longer goal achievement is qualifying for a tournament. And one of the goals in that is getting new shoes. How relevant getting new shoes is to reaching that tournament? Maybe those new shoes are going to help in performance. Maybe they are not. So how relevant are goal setting are is also very important. Then your goal setting has to be extremely time bound. We cannot say in 1 week or 2 weeks or a fortnight. Our goal setting has to be, let's say, 30th of July or 31st of July or 18th of September or 19th of November. So everything has to have a certain date. That date can always be modified, but it is always better to have a time-bound goal. This is one of the more difficult aspects of goal setting, that is keeping it exciting. So we have to keep our goals stimulating and motivating enough for us for all times. So if our goal was interesting or stimulating to us when we set it, but by the time we are reaching, let's say, the second week or the second month, and we don't feel it's really stimulating anymore, and we might not be able to achieve it like this, we have to inculcate something in it that makes it more exciting. So we have to keep our goals exciting. And the last point for us is recorded. We have to have repository of all the steps we have covered to achieve that goal. May it be in training, may it be when you are in competitions, may it be, your preparation of a certain event. Everything has to be documented so that it can be measured or viewed later, so that it helps us in next goal setting. So this is the way we set our smarter goals. I'll be happy to answer any questions about goal setting later. Again, goal setting seems very complicated, but if you start just one goal, let's say one goal that you have to achieve in next 3 days or in next 4 days. And once you're able to make sure that all these areas are covered, all these aspects are covered, and you're able to set the goal and achieve the goal, it will start becoming easier. These are the three types of goals that we have: process, performance, and outcomes. It's always better to start with the process goals and then go to the performance goals and then let the outcome goals or the end results happen on their own. So the first step for us is the process goals. In this, it's as simple as it's self-explanatory. So process goals are the goals that we want to achieve step by step. So the goals of the step. So let's say if you want a certain athlete to be able to hit a perfect serve. So how they hold their racket, how they take their stance. So each thing is a process. The first process is how they hold their racket. So probably for you, your goal can be that, okay, today I'm going to cover two processes of this athlete so that he is able to at least achieve these two processes in next 2 weeks. So these are process goals where the coach looks at the processes of the athlete, of the person that they are training, and help them achieve those process goals. You can also work with your own process goals in terms that, let's say if you have a process goal of being able to help three athletes achieve a certain strategy. So you can write down your processes of what those strategies have step by step, and which athlete has achieved what process, how long did it take them, how did you measure it, and how are you going to review it, and when are you going to review it. So these are a few examples of our types of goals. So outcome goal would be about just winning the match at the tournament. Performance goal would be, okay, your second serve percentage, was it 100%, or that you have to have maximum double faults in the match. So this is how we pen down our performance goals. And our process goals, like I've written, are your correct length of the toss, your correct backhand setup, or your accuracy of the serve. Sorry. These are a few of the goal setting tools. We can discuss the tools individually as well, but these are the basic ones that I have seen coaches use. Hence, I've written these here. So there are a lot of coaches, they use handwritten journal. They have diaries where they write their daily achievements, shorter achievements. So probably in a word or two, you can write down your daily achievements. Some coaches, they use their mobile phone to set reminders. They have countdown apps if they want to achieve something. A lot of times we like to put around posters, motivational posters or quotes, or probably pictures of athletes or inspirational figures that help us achieve our goals. The last one is, a lot of us, we try to work beyond the journals and the notes. And we go into visualization activities where we look at meditation, positive affirmations, and mindfulness techniques for goal setting. I think, Cyrus, this is where we end with our communication and goal setting.
Excellent. So we can take questions for the next 10 odd minutes.
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Hello. So there's one question which has come up, and that's in fact the only question so far.
Right.
Regard to rewarding performance, does this not depend on a player's mental state? What motivates the player, and what does not, compared to a standard formula?
Yes, absolutely. So, like I was mentioning it earlier, there are when you have to get to know your client, when you have to get to know your athlete, you'll have to spend some time every day to understand them a little bit, eventually to understand what sort of what is their really learning style. I have not touched upon the learning style because, again, that's a large area. And to understand your teaching style against athletes' learning style becomes too much of a discussion. So when we talk about what is specifically important, sorry, what is specifically correct for one athlete as a reward might not be absolutely correct for another athlete. So for that understanding, you'll, as a coach, you'll have to be more in touch with the athlete, understand that client. I hope that's what you meant to ask, or if it's something else,
This is Rajesh. That's my question. Hi.
Okay.
Continuation to that, see, when there are three or four players, each of them are different. So their award or reward will be different. How do we not create a complex, like, you know, as a coach? I'm not a coach, but I mean, there are a lot of coaches here. I've seen this create where you know, parents and the group of people talking about saying, hey, the coach is partial towards one student and not towards the other student.
Right. See, I can very well answer for the first part that you said, that how to understand what is right for one and what is not, or how to have that balance with all the athletes, the rewards that we give to all the athletes. So the first step to understanding rewards is that, as a coach, what rewards mean to you, and in your coaching ability, what rewards can you give? So when it comes to rewards, there are some coaching setups where there are, you know, medals and trophies and certificates that are given every week. In such certain coaching setups, there are just verbal rewards that can be given, right? There aren't such tournaments that are giving extrinsic motivation feeding rewards. So we have to first understand what the coach's ability and capability of giving rewards is to start with. Now, let's say if the capability and ability is of giving, you know, the certificates and the medals and everything, or just the name that, okay, today you're the athlete of the week or you're athlete of the month, then that's entirely different. That's impartial because it's probably decided by the whole academy. But if it's about just a coach giving individual rewards on the court, then we have to see that when the coach is giving these subjective rewards, how he's imparting it. Is he imparting it in front of everyone? Is he doing it individually when only the parents are there, or only one or two peers are there? Or is he doing it through message? Or is he doing through the review notes that he's giving at the end of the week? How is he doing it? Now, the coach has to choose that. If there are too many athletes around, then the coach has to make that hard decision that, okay, I am going to give the positive reinforcement and the rewards in terms of writing. I'm going to write the review, or I'm going to probably message the review to the parents or to the athlete by the end of the week, or probably call the athlete to the office and give the review. So there are different ways of giving the rewards that the coach will have to choose. Again, when it comes to the verbal rewards, coach will have to create a balance. And once it becomes sort of a habit for the coach that rewards are given even when an athlete is performing average, then the chances are that in the academy, there are less athletes who are going to be offended by not getting rewards. Because if the coach is giving rewards to almost everyone, then no one is really missed out. I hope that
Thank you.
A little bit more clear. Thank you.
One final question for today. You mentioned about active CMR. What is that, and is there any literature available for that?
Active
CMR.
Just a second.
Hello.
Hello.
You mentioned in the point between the games when you prepare, in the relaxation, you mentioned brief self talk and quick CMR.
PMR, sorry. PMR, progressive muscle relaxation. Hi, am I audible, Amit?
What is that, yes. And how do you do it? Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
so, Amit, it is an 8 weeks of training that we give for PMR, progressive muscle relaxation. We can always have another talk in terms of the mental techniques that can be used, and PMR is one of those major ones. I would not be able to tell you the whole thing because that I'll have to either show you a video also or demonstrate it. But basically what PMR, progressive muscle relaxation, means is that the end result of this technique should be that the athlete on the court should be able to relax or untense his or her muscles voluntarily. So all the muscles that are tight, he or she should be able to just relax them voluntarily. That is the end result of being able to achieve progressive muscle relaxation, PMR technique. But it's done over the period of, so an athlete or a coach would have to train for 8 weeks for PMR, different body parts, and they have to learn to achieve it and then use it on the court. Was that helpful?
Okay, ma'am, I got it. Is it done online or something?
You might get some videos on YouTube about PMR technique. You can watch those. But what I would do is that I'll find a video and I'll send it across. Or perhaps if in future I do have a PMR workshop, then I'll let Cyrus know and he can put it across to you. So it will become easier.
Sure, ma'am. Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
To all our coaches.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for everyone for being here.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you.